The London system is easy to learn and offers White an enviable weapon with which to score the win. White obtains easy and flexible development and has a rock-solid pawn structure. And indeed, as we ease our way through this DVD, we'll see that none other than Garry Kasparov has been attracted by the internal logic running through White's formation.
What I'm going to do now is just to try and break down a few of the typical ideas that we'll be looking at as we go through this introductory DVD so that you don't feel all at sea. I would say there are two key moves after d4, the first of which is the symmetrical d5, which a lot of Queen's Gambit players are going to play. And against that, I believe White's most accurate reaction is to delay the development of the knight on g1 and simply play bishop f4. With a variety of ideas, for instance, if Black sets up a Queen's Gambit formation with e6, White may continue to divert naturally, but at the same time delay that knight on g1 coming into the game. And here we might see a reason. If Black plays bishop d6, White snaps off the bishop and then goes f4. And possibly establishes a favourable stonewall formation. Just going back, if Black isn't too keen on blocking in the bishop on c8 just yet, we can still play our typical idea. And the same idea with bishop d3 takes shape. At the same time, Black may set up a formation where he doesn't offer the exchange of dark square bishops, playing his bishop to e7. And as soon as that bishop comes out to e7 and leaves our bishop unchallenged on f4, then it's time for knight gf3. And we'll see later that if Black carelessly castles in such a position, he can fall victim to a very powerful kingside attack, which might begin with the move h4. Of course, there's no obligation for Black to block in the queen's bishop. And so a lot of players are going to play a Slav formation, just copying what you do, setting up a symmetrical London system in return, if you like. Here, I think White has two very promising approaches, both of which involve the move c4. He can either develop his knight to d2 or his knight to c3. We'll see examples of each as we go through the tape. Queen b6 is the main line. White's quite happy to offer the exchange of queens. And the main point of this is that after c4, c5, White is able to establish pressure against the black queen side with the help of moves such as b4, already threatening b5 in the given position, and then knight d2, the key manoeuvre with the idea of knight b3 to a5, establishing a grip on the position.
Welcome to this Foxy Opnings DVD on 1b4. I want to talk at the outset a little bit about how I'm going to structure this DVD for you. Firstly, we're going to discuss the ideas behind 1b4. Then I'm going to show you a selection of games by the master, Sokolsky himself, to demonstrate how devastating 1b4 was in his hands. We'll then go on to look at some theory. I've pulled out most of the main lines, concentrated on essential information, and tried to show you a way forward in each of these main lines, so that, you know, once you've learned the theory, you'll have a good basic grasp of how the opening works. And finally, we're going to go on to look at some modern games from the last few years where B4 has featured to see whether it's still working at master level. But firstly, the ideas. Well, okay, from my perspective, the most obvious idea behind B4 is to create an unusual position right at the outset, which you have studied and your opponent has not. The element of surprise, the element of unorthodoxy is very apparent after 1b4. And so if you've studied these positions well, it's likely that you're going to have a head start over, well, 99% of your opponents. And so B4 is a very unusual and interesting move. Quite often, it's a provocative move because that pawn on b4 is exposed, it's unprotected. Black often gets carried away in the Sokolsky trying to attack and win this pawn. Sometimes, the b pawn is offered as bait in order to create a central pawn majority. It's interesting, quite often in the Sokolsky, black takes this pawn on b4 only to find that the d and e pawns, which white has been hanging back in the opening, suddenly come forward and cramp him. It's a feature of the Sokolsky that white often gets a central pawn majority, and this feature cramps black in the middle game and runs him out of ideas. b4, well, let's just see. Clearly b4 is an attempt to gain queenside space. White advances quickly on the left hand side of the board, and if a pawn ever reaches b5, as it often does in the Sokolsky, black's minor pieces can be denied use of the c6 square. So it's also an idea in the Sokolsky to march forward quickly on the queenside and try to establish a spatial advantage there. Let's get rid of the colours for the moment, and we come to the final idea of the Sokolsky, which is to establish a strong bishop on b2. Clearly white is intending to follow up the b4 with bishop b2, and the bishop on b2 exerts strong influence down the long diagonal towards the black king side. This is quite a common idea in the Sokolsky. White can whip up an attack against the black king if black castles too early. There's also, of course, direct influence on the central squares d4 and e5. So black, if he wants success against the Sokolsky, must sometimes play to nullify the strong bishop on b2. Alright, well that's it for the summary. Now it's time to go on to, first of all, look at some games by Sokolsky himself. Well, my first game comes from a tournament played in Minsk in 1958. It's an old game, but it's a game by Sokolsky himself playing white against a fellow named Skugach. Now, Sokolsky was a very original attacking player of Grandmaster standard, and he used 1b4 with success over decades against all comers, including such great players as Paul Kiris. So the opening rightly bears his name. 1b4 is also known as the Polish opening or the Orang-Utan opening, but the name Sokolsky is the one generally used. Unusual positions abound after 1b4. It's a very provocative move, and this game demonstrates quite clearly what might happen if black gets carried away. Now Skugach plays a very critical move, e5, and with this move black is immediately threatening the pawn on b4. White more or less ignores the attack and counterattacks the pawn on e5. And in this particular game, black decides to shut down the diagonal with f6, retaining his threat to b4. We're going to see what happens a bit later on when black takes on b4 immediately. That is one of the most dangerous lines for white to face. But let's note for the time being that unless white takes drastic steps to get rid of this brick wall in front of the bishop on b2, then black is going to be able to establish a very comfortable game with moves such as d5, bishop e6, bishop d6, and so on. For instance, if white plays a move like a3 in this position, then I think black just goes d5 and then bishop e6. And this is very comfortable. The bishop on b2 has been blunted. So Sokolsky.
Hi, International Grandmaster Ron W. Henley, and in this Foxy Opening DVD series, we're going to look at the London system, and specifically with the move order 1, d4, d5, 2, bishop f4. This is the sequence we are going to build our opening repertoire around. Now, in our investigation, we will start with the early history of the London system. The first practitioner was actually James Mason, and in fact, the variation with d4, d5, 2, bishop f4 was actually called the Mason variation up until the London tournament of 1922. Then it became known as, quote, the London variation. So let's talk a minute about James Mason, the early practitioner. He was born November 19, 1849, and lived until about 1905. He was an Irish-born chess player, journalist, writer, who became one of the world's best half a dozen players in the 1880s. In fact, according to chess metrics, at one time he was actually ranked number 2 in the world behind William Steinitz. His original name is actually unknown. He was adopted as a child and only took the name James Mason when he and his family moved to the United States in 1861. There he learned chess and eventually secured a job at the New York Herald. Mason first made his mark in the chess scene in 1876 when he won the 4th American Chess Congress in Philadelphia, the New York Clipper Tournament, and defeated Henry Bird in a match by the comfortable margin of 13-6. In 1878, he settled in England. His best tournament results were 3rd at the Strong Vienna Tournament and 3rd at Nuremberg, 1883, and equal 2nd in Hamburg. At the famous Hastings 1895, often considered the strongest tournament of the 19th century, he finished tied for 12th to 4th, 14th, with 9.5 points out of 21. Mason wrote several books on chess, the most popular being Principles of Chess in Theory and Practice. That was published in 1894, The Art of Chess in 1895, and Chess Openings in 1897, and Social Chess in 1900. In 1903, he became seriously ill and had to curtail almost all of his activities for the remainder of his life. He died on January 12, 1905, in Essex, and is buried nearby in the churchyard. In terms of his chess strength and legacy, according to chess metrics, his peak in October 1876, his equivalent rating would have been 2715 by today's standards, and again, as we said, he would have been ranked number 2 behind only William Steinitz. His single best chess performance ever was Vienna, 1882, where he scored a fantastic 15 out of 23 possible points, 65%, against players rated on average 2622. His performance rating in that event would have been 2732 by today's standards. So now we're going to look at the early history, and among the games we're going to look at, of course, James Mason versus Alexander Fritz, played in Wiesbaden, 1880. We'll also look at James Mason versus Alexander Wittek, played in Vienna, 1882. And then another game where James Mason plays Mikhail Chigorin, London, 1883. And Mason was not alone. Famous player of the era, Joseph Henry Blackburn, for 50 years, the Black Death, was considered the best player from England. We will see his game against Max Harmanis, played in Breslau, 1889. Is James Mason versus Alexander Fritz, played in Wiesbaden, 1880. So after d4, d5, bishop f4, Black plays a symmetrical bishop f5. Now here, Mason plays the interesting knight c3. Now in principle, I generally tend to be averse to blocking in my c-pawn with a knight, but there are a number of openings, Varisov's among others, not only acceptable practice, it's probably the best way to try for an advantage, quick development. Black plays e6, white plays a3, a little bit conservative, stopping the bishop from coming to b4. Black plays bishop d6, looking to exchange, and white retreats. Now the plan of black capturing on f4 and accepting double pawns with e3, bishop takes, pawn takes, that type of structure, we will be seeing that in the Rubinstein-Tartikauer game later. But anyway, after bishop to g3, black now plays c5. White plays the interesting d takes c5, bishop takes c5, and then e3. And here, black makes an interesting decision to put the knight on d7. Why not just simply straightforward knight to c6? But knight d7 was played in the game, knight f3, now knight e7. Okay, bishop e2, black castles, white castles, and now knight to g6. probably a little bit dubious, as this kind of cuts off the light squared bishop's retreat back. And so rook c8 would have been preferable. However, after knight g6, white very adeptly plays knight to d4, and this will secure the bishop pair for him. Black elects to play bishop takes d4, and surrenders the bishop without any consideration. Ironically enough, it was actually after knight d4 preferable to simply do a take back with knight e7, and then that way you could meet knight takes on f5 with knight takes f5, going after the dark squared bishop of white's. And then bishop f4, you could actually play a little aggressively with g5, bishop g3, knight takes, pawn takes, and you have a bishop of opposite color middle game that's going to be a little bit unclear. After knight e7, of course, white could just play rook c1 and not take the bishop on f5, and probably white's slightly for choice. But going back to the game, after knight d4, black complied and played bishop takes d4, and now white played e takes d4. Seemingly forced, however, today's more dynamic player may have considered the pawn sack with queen takes d4. For example, bishop c2, rook c1, bishop back, and then bishop d6, rook e8, and then knight b5, with pretty promising compensation for the exchange. But going back, after bishop takes d4, e takes d4, a very safe recapture, and now rook c8. And we can see the pressure coming up on the c-file, followed and the bishop exerting pressure on c2, creates a little bit of a discomfort for white, and white plays bishop d3, offering to just return, or that is, part with the bishop pair. However, with the fondness for the bishop pair, I would have preferred other methods. For example, queen b2, queen b6, rook a2, ugly but with purpose, rook c6, trying to double on the c-file, and then h4, trying to launch a kingside attack. That would be one plan. Another plan, instead of bishop d3, would be to play rook c1, simply protecting the pawn on c2. And after queen b6, you could play knight a4, attacking the queen and guarding your b2 pawn, and then on queen c6, you play simply c4, trying to blast the position open. Either of these plans, in my mind, would have been preferable to simply playing bishop d6 and allowing black to trade off your bishop, which in fact happens. Bishop takes, queen takes, but now black plays f5. And to me, this is simply strategically wrong. Even though the move is not, quote, terrible in and of itself, he needlessly weakens the pawn on e6, and he's not really able to build up such an impressive kingside attack. Instead, he should have continued play on queenside where he had some advantage. For example, queen b6, knight a4, queen c6, knight back to c3, and then knight to b6. And you can see black has the makings of a very promising queenside Minardi attack, and white is a long way from generating anything on the kingside. But f5 happened, and white just simply played f3, and then on f4, tucked his bishop back on f2. And now black comes with queen g5. And as we said, he looks to build a kingside attack, but he has no real advantage in the sector to justify such a plan. So once again, queen to b6 would have been preferable. But after queen g5, rook at fd1, we see white begin to systematically pile on the blackward, on the backward black pawn on e6. A very logical move. Notice that queen b5, knight to b6, knight e4, queen c7, and then knight c5 was also a very promising alternative. But rook at fd1, and now black actually makes a tactical blunder. In his effort to combine attack with defense, he plays rook f6. This defends the pawn on e6 and has hopes of bringing the rook over to join in a kingside attack. Correct, though, was rook c6, defending laterally from the other side. And then queen b5 can be met with rook b8, and black's okay. Very solid position. But in the game, after rook at fd1, rook f6, Mason now plays rook e2. Again, very logical, looking to double rooks. However, he missed a tactic with queen b5, attacking the knight on d7 and attacking the pawn on d7. After knight b6, the knight fork attacks the queen on g5, the rook on f6, and the knight can't be taken because of the lateral pin by the white queen on the black d pawn. and I believe this is what he overlooked. So again, instead of rook e2, another variation of queen d5, with note that the exchange check, rook takes on c3 falls short, because after pawn takes, knight b6, then you have a4, knight c4, h4, knight takes, queen check, rook back, queen check, king over, and then take on h4, queen takes, and queen e7, rook e7, forcing a winning endgame. But let's go back. Mason missed the moment with queen b5, instead played rook e2, a good solid positional move, to be sure. And now black plays a6, once and for all taking the queen b5 option off the table. So after rook at a to e1, we can see white building pressure on that black pawn on e6. And now we can see why I'm now a fan of the earlier f5 that black played. So now king steps up to defend the pawn. Notice that knight at d to f8, knight to a4, coming into c5 would be quite pleasant for white. So after king f7, white has two interesting options. He could either play knight a2, okay, or the move in the game where he just plays king to f1. And now after knight h4, he played bishop takes, rook takes, and then a very nice little combination, knight takes on d5, attacking the black rook on f6. And now after e takes d6, black would have done well to consider simply moving the rook away. But after e takes d5, rook e7 check. We can see the white rooks enter into the black position. In the game, he plays king f8, definitely a question mark. Would have been more accurate and much safer to play king to g8. And then on rook takes d7, queen takes h2, with a bit of counterplay. Both kings are a bit exposed. Instead, after king f8, rook takes d7, white recovers his piece. Black takes the pawn in h2, but then the very powerful move, rook to e5. And now, black plays queen h1 check. But why was rook e5 so powerful? Well, basically, it held the black counterattack at bay, since rook g6, threatening the g2 square, fails to queen f5 check. Now, first off, if king g8, then you have the pretty simple mate, check, and back rank mate. And in this Foxy Opening DVD series, we're going to look at the London system, and specifically with the move order 1, d4, d5, 2, bishop f4. This is the sequence we are going to build our opening repertoire around. The next game, Li Shin versus IM Robert Hamilton, was played on the Chess Super Site in 2016. And a beautiful tactical skirmish, very nice how he built the initiative. And then the third game is Axiong versus Gesserchow, played on ICC, game 15 of 2015. And this little miniature actually follows a very famous Fischer versus Petrosian game. And in this particular game, black tries to exchange light squared bishops and unfortunately walks into a royal pin. The first of three games we will look at from my personal students is A Bite of Data versus Nathan, played in 2015. And again, it comes from the Kairokan exchange move order. Let's take a quick look. Takes, takes, bishop d3, c3, bishop out to g4. And of course, this variation is well known from the time of Bobby Fischer. Queen to b3, queen to d7. Now this is a little bit different. Bishop to f4. But nonetheless, after knight d2, we soon get to a fairly standard position. Now, most of the positions we saw earlier, the black queen was on c8. Here, black gives up the bishop pair with bishop takes f3, knight takes f3, and then bishop d7. Another alternative is bishop d6, offering a pawn sacrifice. After bishop e7, white goes knight e5. Now, the first point to know here is a little bit of a trap. If knight takes e5, d takes e5, knight h5 attacking the bishop allows the pin with bishop b5. Now, of course, we never expect people to fall into such things, but you never know. So after knight e5, black has to lose a tempo and retreat his queen. But now, an interesting interpretation of the position. In most of the games we've seen up to this point, white castles, puts his rooks on f1, e1, goes queen to c2, and tries to build up a kingside attack. But here's another idea. Knight takes on c6. Of course, this allows black to take with pawn. Notice that taking with queen, of course, is taboo, because bishop to b5, once again, pin and win. So therefore, not only do we allow black to take with the pawn, he must take with the pawn, and then we castle, and he castles. And basically, we've transformed the situation from where we are trying to attack on the king's side, and he's trying his minority attack, to a situation where we're saying we have two bishops with flexible pawns on both sides of the board. Bishop e5. Pawn to c5, queen to c2, and now c4, an interesting but probably not quite correct decision. Bishop back to e2, and now knight to d7. We retreat our bishop, of course, and black plays g6. And now we play d3, trying to undermine the pawn on c4. And here he plays c takes d3. He should instead play knight to b6 and try to maintain control of the c4 square. And then white has choices. One would be to play h4, another would be to play bishop f4, with the idea of g3 and h4, and get back the idea of attacking on the king's side, since the knight has wandered away. But in the game after b3, black played c takes b3, and then after a takes b3, white is clearly for choice. The half-open a-file, the nice pawns tight together, and the two bishops. After bishop f6, threatening the little trick with bishop takes d4, of course, we go rook at f to c1 to protect our queen, and on queen b7, now bishop a6. What this does is it freezes the black pawn on a7, queen b6, and now queen d3. We clamp down on the black queen side. Notice, of course, we also set the trap queen takes b3, rook at c to b1 would in fact trap the queen. Black plays knight b8, giving our bishop the boot. Well, of course, we're in no rush to let him have our bishop. We go bishop back to b5, and then on a6, bishop to a4. So what have we achieved with this maneuver, bishop to a6 to b5 to a4? Well, we've really pretty much clamped down on black's queenside counterplay. After knight c6, we now shift to the other side, since there's no danger on the queen side, and we go queen f3, showing superior mobility due to our space advantage. Black goes bishop g7, and as we've seen in many other middle games, h4. There goes the h-pawn. Black goes h5. We go bishop f4. Black, sensing danger on the king side, cartwheels his knight over. But we continue full steam ahead, g4. After h takes, queen takes, the knight pops up to f5, and I have to say that is a very nice attractive outpost for the knight, but we also have our game plan, which is h5, to open the h-file. Black plays pawn takes. He would have been better served trying to trade bishops with bishop h6, and then, for example, bishop takes, knight takes, queen up, king up, queen check, and the game goes on, but white does have a bit of an edge. In the game, after h5, he trades pawns. Queen takes, and we succeeded, like in many games we've seen before, opening the h-file. Now the challenge, though, is we don't really have all our rooks and knights over there like we usually do. Black goes queen d8. King up to g2. And white goes after queen h4, you'd think white would retreat his queen and try to keep the queens on the board. But, rook h1. And after the trade of queens and rook takes, black goes f6. White now goes rook e1, put a little touch. Hi, International Grandmaster Ron W. Henley, and in this Foxy Opening DVD series, we are going to look at the London system, and specifically with the move order 1, d4, d5, 2, bishop f4. This is the sequence we are going to build our opening repertoire around. And in this Foxy Opening DVD series, we are going to look at the London system, and specifically with the move order 1, d4, d5, 2, bishop f4. This is the sequence we are going to build our opening repertoire around. The next three series of games, we will look at classical setup where black plays e6 and white plays the standard move order 6, knight at g to f3. But within this group of games, there's a number of different plans that the player playing black can try. And so we're kind of going to break it down a little bit by that category. In the first of these, we see black playing an early 6, knight h5, chasing after our beloved dark square bishop. That's the game Degabotsi versus Savchenko, Budapest 2004, which is a nice win for white in 17 moves. Then we're going to see a couple of games, two games where black plays 7, queen e7. There we see the game Eric Prie versus Degabotsi from the Condom Open 2012, a white win in 35 moves. We will also see another game, Eric Prie versus Gazzoli from France, 2012, and another white win in 33 moves. Then we will look at games where black tries to plan bishop takes g3 and queen to d6. After that, we will look at a game where black simply castles, and Kamsky plays one of his favorite moves, 8, bishop to b5, fighting for control of the e5 square. There we will look at the game Kamsky-Lee Rufing, and we'll take a brief glimpse at Magnus Carlsen versus Sergei Karjakin from the World Blitz Championship, which was equal, but Magnus lost in 47 moves. And then we will look where black plays castles, followed by 8, queen e7. And that will be the game Gadakamsky versus Sam Shanklin from the Eastern Class Championship 2014, and another very, very nice win by Gata in 36 moves. We're going to look at a game where black plays an early knight h5, chasing our dark squared bishop. Black chased our bishop, but white played the more traditional 2 knight f3 move order. But then 3 bishop f4, c5, c3, and knight to d2. Here, 6 knight h5, chases after our dark squared bishop. White played bishop to g5, attacking the black queen, and the queen went to b6, attacking the pawn on b2. Now here, of course, white can very easily think about playing queen out to b3, offering trade queens, protecting the pawn. Instead, white played the very interesting d takes c5. This surrenders the white d-pawn, and offers black the choice of recapturing on c5 or trying to go in for queen takes b2, which I have to say is not totally clear. But let's just look at kind of a sample variation to give you some ideas. Knight to d4 unleashes the queen on the knight, also has the possibility of bringing the knight over to b5 and then trying to trap the black queen. Well, g6 defending the knight would be a logical move, and then rook c1 protecting the pawn on c3. After a kick on the bishop and capturing, play could go something along these lines. The fork is threatened. When he defends the fork, then you have moves like rook over, and bishop to c4 is an amazing resource. Attacking the queen, when the queen is captured, you then have the very clever rook a1, queen b2, and knight c4 checking the queen. Now again, obviously this is not forced. However, it was analysis that was computer assisted and does show you some of the attacking resources that White had in mind when he played d takes c5. Black, a 2600 player, quite understandably confronted over the board with d takes c5, did not want to go in for the murkiness of queen takes b2. And from a practical point of view, totally understood. It's not the kind of thing you want to go into if you haven't prepared it very, very well beforehand. So in the game, he played a very logical move, bishop takes c5, recapturing his pawn. But then came b4, launching the b-pawn, gaining time. Bishop went e7, and then b5. Now I have to say, this style of play for me is rather a bit difficult, but it is the kind of thing that computers teach us, is that pawns of the initiative are not weak. Myself, I tend to be very reluctant to just give up squares along the c-file, as this type of advance does. Here, Black plays knight to b8, probably a bad choice. As Black, I would think to play knight to a5 and help fight for the c4 square. As White, before I played b5, that would be the move I would be concerned about. And then, for example, bishop takes, king takes, queen out, knight back, queen check, and White does have a bit of initiative here. However, another possibility would be to simply play h6. And this is probably the correct choice for Black. The idea being that after bishop h4, you could play g5, and on pawn takes, Black has two bishops with a very murky situation. Just note very quickly that on rook b1, Black does not play queen to c6 and get zapped with bishop to b5, but instead on rook b1, he simply has to chill with queen back to c7, and I would say the position is pretty unclear. But let's go back to the game. After the blitzkrieg style attack with b5, Black retreated the knight back to b8. And we can see even though the white pawn structure is a bit raggedy, the black queen side is completely undeveloped at this point. Well, bishop takes, king takes, and then c4, exclamation point, and White's aggressive opening play has certainly been rewarded. Black played knight back to f6, but let's take a look. For example, if he takes on c4, well then knight takes, queen check, and queen a3 with dire consequences about to happen on c6. After queen back, a move like rook over, and you can see the white attack pretty much plays itself. That looks like a game from the 1880s, back when the London system first came into vogue. So going back after c4, White definitely has a clear advantage, certainly in development. Knight came back to f6, and here White should simply play a move like rook c1 or queen a4, both offering very good chances of building a serious initiative with the black king stuck in the center and a clear lead in development. Instead, after knight f6, c takes d5 dissipated a pretty good part of White's advantage. Play continued with pawn takes, and yes, Black does have an isolated d-pawn, however the white pawn going all the way to b5 kind of mitigates that advantage to some degree, but White also has control of the d4 square. After bishop e2, I think White has a still slight positional edge, but it's not what it could have been. Bishop e6, a4, queen over, knight over, queen over, queen up to b2, knight over, and a5. Now again, I would say White definitely has a little bit of an edge. Secure post on d4, queen side space advantage. Black plays knight back. White contests the open file. Knight goes to e5. A little defensive move, stopping any kind of knight to g4 action. Bishop goes back, trades a pair, trades, now queen over, bishop up, and now a very interesting move, bishop to g4. At this point, black gives up his knight for the bishop. And after pawn takes, white has achieved an endgame that the Russians are very fond of, where he has queen and knight versus queen and bishop. In fact, one could almost call this the, quote, Russian endgame, and especially when you have an unassailable knight on the square. Now notice, of course, if bishop takes g4, queen takes h7, there's white's tactical justification for this bishop g4 idea. So in the game, after knight g4, h takes g4, black plays g6, but then white plays g5. Black goes king e7, and then queen up. So you can see white does have a bit of play on dark squares. Black plays b6. This freezes the white pawn on d5, so the bishop can keep an eye on it. But after pawn takes, the excellent queen to a1. The idea of this, of course, is that the queen simply wants to penetrate either to a7 or a8. After queen a1, queen b4 was the decisive blunder of the game. White struck with knight c6 check, obviously forking the king and the queen. Black was forced to capture, but then the intermezzo schwischenschach, queen to f6 check, brought black's resignation. And why is that? Because after queen f6 check, pawn takes, the endgame with this monster pawn on c6 is simply quite lost. For example, queen c5, check, and push. Check, queen over, trying for perpetual, you simply promote, and that's the end of the perpetual. So to summarize the game, Gigabotsi versus Savchenko from the Ubida Open 1998, point one, against black's early e6 and 6 knight h5, white played 7 bishop to g5, and then met queen b6 with the interesting 8 d takes c5, offering the pawn on b2. Point 2, white gained a queenside initiative with 9 b4, 10 b5, 12 c4, but 13 c takes d5 was a bit dubious and let black almost equalize. Point 3, with 13 knight d4 and 20 a5, white maintained a slight positional plus. Point 4, in the queen plus knight versus queen plus bishop ending, the powerful 33 queen a1 check exclamation point was followed by the crushing 34 knight to c6 check, forcing a winning queen ending, thanks to white's passed c pawn. Next we will...
Hello everyone, I'm International Master Andrew Martin, and welcome to this Foxy Opnings DVD on the Jobava London system. And on this video, I'm going to be presenting an almost entirely new method of play. Now, the advantage of the Jobava London system is mainly the lack of theory on it. Opponents can't go to the books and pull out some antidote because they simply don't exist. Players of the calibre of Magnus Carlsen have been using this system to good effect in recent years. And we're going to start with an inspiring Magnus Carlsen game. This game was played in June 2020. Incidentally, all the games on this video are going to be from 2020. So you can guarantee you're going to be presented with the latest information. And this was played in the Clutch Championships held the Lee Chess website. Carlsen's opponent with black is Jeffrey Zhong. Now, let's just see the opening moves of the system, where white plays d4, black plays knight f6. Now comes knight c3. Well, when you see that move, you automatically think white's leading up to playing e4. So the majority of black players are going to stop white from playing e4. Incidentally, we will take a look at other ways for black a bit later on. And now comes bishop f4. Well, what can we call this? It has no name. It's an original queen pawn system. It's not a Verisov because the bishop's not on g5. It is a kind of London system, but you wouldn't expect the knight to be on c3 at this early stage. And it's not a lead up to a black Mardima because it's going to take white quite some time to prepare the advance e4 in this position.
So it's a kind of hybrid of all these different openings, and black has original problems to solve. Now let's just go through this game as an inspiring example. And black decided to play e6. That's one of the mainline moves, very common. And black's thinking about playing c5 and getting a kind of French position, which looks as though it should be quite reasonable for him. Anyway, Carlsen played e3. An audacious alternative here is knight to b5. I mean, that looks ridiculous, doesn't it? It looks like a duffer's move, as Tarash would describe it. But there's a sound positional basis behind it, and that is that black has got to protect c7 somehow, and the only reasonable way to do it, without giving up the bishop pair, is to play knight a6. And after that, the knight on a6 is on a very bad circuit. So whilst white loses time here, after c6, well, the knight's got to go back to c3. The knight on a6 is very badly placed. And yes, black has gained a move, but is it the type of move he wants to gain? Somehow he's got to get that knight back onto a decent circuit. And practice has shown that white's chances are pretty good here. Anyway, going back to our featured game, Carlsen obviously doesn't like that and prefers to play e3. John cuts out any idea of knight b5 straight away by playing his bishop to b4, and white sensibly plays knight e2. So already we're a little bit off the beaten track. It is a queen's pawn game, but it's a very unusual one. And knight e2 just simply says, well, I'm going to play a3, and then you've got to decide what you're going to do with your bishop. Anyway, black castled. White did indeed play a3, and John dropped back with the bishop to e7. He's certainly thinking about moves like c5 quite quickly, and then knight c6, queen b6, getting a kind of French defence position. Now, Carlsen's next move is extraordinary, and you'd never be able to guess it. He played knight g1. Undevelopment. It looks ridiculous, but the knight on e2 was gumming up the works for white, so white simply gets it to a better square. Again, this looks like a loss of time, but I urge you to consider what happens in the game. And certainly here, black is being given original problems to solve. He's on his own. He's got to solve the problems of this very strange position. John came up with knight h5. And Carlsen, perhaps slightly surprisingly, decided to surrender the bishop with d takes c5. Black whipped off the bishop. White takes back, and now bishop takes c5. Bishop d3. Seems to me Carlsen aims for an harmonious position in the opening for his pieces. Doesn't worry too much about whether he's better or not. He just tries to get a harmonious position. And one of the ideas of the Jobava London system is to start a kingside attack. So you begin to wonder whether actually white is threatening the Greek gift sacrifice in this position. For instance, if black plays knight c6, can white get away with bishop takes h7 check? That was certainly in the back of Zhong's mind as he blocked the white attack by playing g6, but that runs straight into Carlsen's attacking move h4. And you're going to see this type of kingside attack is very common in the Jobava London system. Certainly against unsuspecting black players, there's a very good chance that white could land a big punch using this idea. Well, I mean, it's fairly straightforward. White was going to play h5 and then open the h-file and try and make black's king. Black developed, perhaps not quite believing in what white was doing. And it certainly looks that as though black has got a decent position here. He's defending his king and he's attacking the pawn on f4. Carlsen defended with queen to d2. And now black struck out with e5. Well, perhaps he didn't need to do that, but I guess white was threatening to castle on the queen side and then just to go for broke on the h-file. It's not rocket science. So black decides to break that up by sacrificing a pawn. Does it work? We will see. Carlsen takes the pawn. Black attacks the knight, and white defends his knight. So for the time being, white has been talked out of the immediate opening of the h-file. And now black even gets to regain his pawn by taking on f4. But castles on the queen side. It seems that white can get a vicious attack here without his dark square bishop, which is quite unusual. Of course, the dark square bishop for black is on c5 rather than g7. And this, as we're going to see in the upcoming play, makes a big difference. Well, Carson wastes no time opening up the king, and now the knight comes into g5. He knows he can't hang around because black's counterattack is also quite strong. Bishop f5 was played, and now in came the knight to h7. Very direct play by Magnus Carlsen. Rook fd8, Zhong saves his rook, but now knight check, king f8, rook h8 check, and the finish is not difficult to work out. Rook h7 check, king f8, and now Carlsen swings his rook across to h1. And black had nothing better than to resign because, well, white's threatening checkmate in two moves, starting with rook h8 check. So that was a quick win for Magnus Carlsen against a very strong opponent, and a good example of the kingside attack, the swift kingside attack that white can bring to bear using this very unusual opening system. Okay, well, after that Carlsen epic to begin with, let me show you a second game where I can truthfully
Several times on my DVDs about openings, I said that I do not normally recommend play a lot of gambits, because when you play gambits, you don't learn a lot of positional aspects of the opening and of the game of chess. But sometimes it's okay to play gambit to learn to get the skill of attack, to learn how to attack and to improve your attacking abilities. And I'm contradicting myself, but I know that from time to time it's okay to play gambit, not to have, but you cannot have gambit as the main opening in your opening repertoire. But sometimes for learning purposes it's okay to play gambit also. And my guest is the specialist in attacking positions and how to attack, and Grandmaster Larry Christiansen, and he wrote even a book, Storming the Chess, Storming Barricades. It's about the art of attack. And here I want to pass him the microphone to talk about certain gambits in the opening, and by learning these gambits you will definitely improve your attacking abilities and attacking skills. And here is my guest, Grandmaster Larry Christiansen.
Hi, this is Larry Christiansen. We're going to be talking gambits in this video. And we're going to start with the Goring Gambit. That's arises from the double king pawn. The Goring Gambit is related to the famous Danish Gambit, where white sacrifices two pawns. Also reminiscent as a little gioco piano, Italian game characteristics, and some Scotch game characteristics. Well, let's get right to it. And like most gambits, if not all gambits, the Goring Gambit with 4c3 here is an attempt by white to offer material to gain time. Time being deployment, quick mobilization of his forces, deployment of his forces. And before talking a bit about the concrete variations of this gambit, black does